Hello everyone. In this presentation, we are going to see alternative airways, endotracheal tubes, and laryngeal mask. What are the objectives? The objectives are the indications for an alternative airway during resuscitation, how to select and prepare the equipments for endotracheal intubation, how to use a laryngoscope to insert an endotracheal tube, how to determine if the endotracheal tube is in the trachea, how to use an endotracheal tube to suction thick secretion from the trachea, when to consider using a laryngeal mask for positive pressure ventilation, how to place a laryngeal mask. What are the indications for alternate airways? If PPV with the face mask does not result in clinical improvement, an endotracheal tube or laryngeal mask is strongly recommended to improve the ventilation efficacy. If PPV lasts for more than a few minutes, an endotracheal tube or a laryngeal mask may improve the efficacy and ease of assisted ventilation. If chest compression are necessary, an endotracheal tube will be maximize the efficacy of positive pressure breath and allow the compressor to keep compression from the head end of the bed. If intubation is not successful or feasible, laryngeal mask may be used. An endotracheal tube provides the most reliable airway access in the special circumstance, such as stabilization of the newborn with the suspected diaphragmatic hernia, for surfactant administration, for direct tracheal suction if airway is obstructed by thick secretion. A person experienced in endotracheal intubation should be immediately available to assist at every delivery. This is a laryngeal mask airway. Equipments. What equipment should be available for airway insertion? The equipment should be clean, protected from the contamination. The first one is laryngoscope. Laryngoscope handled with an extra set of batteries and extra bulbs. Laryngoscope blades. Blade number 1 for term babies, 0 for preterm babies, 00 for very preterm babies. In newborn, we are using straight blades rather than the curved blades. Endotracheal tubes with internal diameter of 2.5, 3 and 3.5 millimeter. Stillet is optional. If you want, we can use stillets. CO2 monitor or detector, it is optional. Suction setup with suction catheter size 10 French or 12 French for suctioning from the pharynx. Sides 8 French or 5 French or 6 French for suctioning from endotracheal tubes of various size. Waterproof adhesive tapes or tube securing device. Measuring tape and endotracheal tube insertion depth table. Scissors, meconium aspirator, stethoscope, positive pressure ventilation device, that is TPS resuscitator, ambubat, and tubing for blended air and oxygen, pulse oximeter, sensor and cover, laryngeal mask size 1 or other supraglottic device, and 5 ml syringe. What type of endotracheal tube should be used? The endotracheal tube should have a uniform diameter throughout the length of the tube. Taper or cuffed tubes are not recommended for neonatal resuscitation. Endotracheal tubes have centimeter marking along the side of measuring the distance to tip of the tube. Many tubes will also have a lines of or marking near the tip that are inserted to be vocal cord guide. When the tube is inserted so that vocal cords are positioned between these two sets of lines, the tip of the tube is expected to be above the carina. However, the location and design of the lines varies considerably between manufacturers. So the vocal cord guide is only an approximation and may not reliably indicate the correct insertion depth. How to choose tube size based on weight and gestational age? So less than 1000 grams of baby or less than 28 weeks of gestation, we are using 2.5 millimeter of ET tube. Baby born between 1000 and 2000 grams or baby born between 28 weeks of gestation and 34 weeks of gestation, we are using 3 size of ET tube. Baby born more than 2000 gram birth weight or more than 34 weeks of gestation, we are using 3.5 millimeter internal diameter of ET tube. We are not using 4 millimeter internal diameter of ET tube no more. Preparation of laryngoscope supply. The correct size laryngoscope blade we should use: number 0 for preterm babies, number 1 for term babies, and number 00 for extreme preterm babies. Check laryngoscope light whether it is working or not. Adjust the suction source to 80 to 100 millimeter mercury. Use large suction catheter greater than or equal to 10 French for oral suction. Have a small catheter for suctioning endotracheal tube. The suction catheter size for ET of various size inner diameter. For 2.5 millimeter internal diameter of ET tube, we can use 5 French or 6 French of catheter. We can use 6 French or 8 French of catheter for 3 size of internal millimeter ET tube. For 3.5 millimeter internal diameter ET tube, we can use 8 French suction catheter. Preparation for intubation. So prepare resuscitation device and mask, turn on the oxygen, head stethoscope, cut tape, and prepare endotracheal tube stabilizer. So how to assist during intubation? The assistant for the procedure should have ensure equipments available and prepared for intubation, correctly position the baby and stabilize the head, provide free flow oxygen to give oxygen and provide suction, hand endotracheal tube to incubator, apply Cricut pressure if asked. Provide positive pressure ventilation between the attempts, connect the endotracheal tube to resuscitation device and connect CO2 device detector if it is available, and auscultate the heart rate to assess the improvement. Note CO2 detector color change to position the ET tube in the trachea, and auscultate breath sounds and observe the chest movements whether it is equally audible on both sides of axilla, and help to secure the tube. So these are the upper airway anatomy. The anatomical landmarks are: the one is epiglottis, the lid-like structure overhanging the glottis. Number 2 is thyrohyoid membrane. The lower portion of the cartilage protruding the larynx. 4 is cricoid cartilage. Lower portion of the cartilage protecting the larynx. 5 is glottis, the lid-like structure overhanging the opening of the larynx leading to trachea flanked by the vocal cords. What are the important anatomical landmarks in the neonatal airway? Epiglottis, the lid-like structure overhanging glottis. Glottis, the opening of the larynx leading to the trachea flanked by the vocal cords. Vocal cords, mucous membrane covered ligaments on both sides of glottis. Trachea, portion of the airway extending from the larynx to the carina. What is carina? Where the trachea branches divides into two main bronchi. Main bronchus, that the two air passages leading from the trachea to the lungs. valliculi, the pouch formed by the base of the tongue and the epiglottis. Larynx, portion of the airway connecting the pharynx and the trachea. These are the anatomical landmarks we can see while intubating the baby. So as we have seen early, we can see the glottis, that is the opening, vocal cords, the white structure, the V-shaped structures, and below glottis we can see the esophagus, and above epiglottis we can see the tongue. So the baby's head should be midline and should be in a sniffing position. So neck slightly extended provides the best view of the airway. If the neck is too flexed, leads to obstructed view, and too extended, that is hyper extended glottis above the line of slight, and the trachea is narrowed. The position of the airway for intubation. The correct position is the line of sight clear. Tongue will be lifted by the laryngoscope blade. The airway should be in a straight line. We can see the vocal cords. If it is too extended, it will obstruct the airway. Always hold the laryngoscope in the left hand, irrespective of the handedness. How to intubate? Get ready to insert the laryngoscope. Step 1. Stabilize the newborn's head in a sniffing position. So not too flexed, not too extended. Deliver free flow oxygen during the procedure. Step 2. Insert the laryngoscope. Use your right index finger to gently open the baby's mouth and insert the laryngoscope blade into the right side of the baby's mouth and slide the blade over the right side of the tongue towards the midline. Gently push the tongue towards the left side of the mouth and advance the blade until the tip lies just beyond the base of the tongue in the valicula. Lift the entire laryngoscope in the direction that the handle is pointing, moving the tongue out of the way to expose the glottis. You may need to tilt the tip of the blade very slightly to lift the epiglottis. When the first learning the procedure, operator have a tendency to bend the wrist, pulling the top of the handle towards themselves in a rocking motion against the baby's upper gum. This will not proceed the desired way of the glottis and may injure the baby's lips and gums. This is the method for lifting the laryngoscope. The correct method is in the direction of the stump of the laryngoscope. Don't do a rocking method. The glottis appears at the very top of your view as you look down the laryngoscope. An assistant can help bring the glottis into view by using his thumb or first finger to provide gentle pressure on the baby's thyroid or cricoid cartilage. The assistant should direct the pressure downwards and towards the baby's right ear. Suction if necessary for visualization. This is a gentle pressure over the cricoid and thyroid cartilage to view the glottis. After identifying the key landmarks, once you have identified the vocal cords, hold the laryngoscope steady, maintain your view of the vocal cords, and ask the assistant to place the endotracheal tube in your right hand. Insert the tube into right side of the baby's mouth with the concave curve in the horizontal plane. Do not insert the tube through the laryngoscope's open channel. This will obstruct your view of the vocal cord. After insertion, direct the tube into the hypopharynx and advance the tip towards the vocal cords. As the tip approaches the vocal cord, pivot the tubes into vertical plane so that the tip is directed upward. When the vocal cord is open, advance the tube until the vocal cords are positioned between the vocal cord guidelines. Your assistant may feel the tube pass beneath his finger. Note the centimeter depth marking on the outside of the tube that aligns with the baby's upper limb. If the vocal cords are closed, wait for them to open. Do not touch the closed vocal cords with the tip of the tube and never try to force the tube between closed cords. If the cords do not open, wait within 30 seconds. Stop and resume ventilation with the mask until you prepare to re-attempt insertion. Use your right hand to hold the tube tightly against the baby's heart palate. Carefully remove the laryngoscope without displacing the tube. If a stylet was used, an assistant should remove it from the endotracheal tube, again being sure that the operator is careful to hold the tube in place. An assistant should attach CO2 detector and PVP positive pressure ventilation device to the endotracheal tube. Having the same person hold the endotracheal tube and positive pressure ventilation may help to avoid accidental extubation. Once the positive pressure ventilation device is attached, begin ventilation through the tube. The steps of intubation should be completed within approximately 30 seconds. The baby is not being ventilated during the procedure, so rapid action is essential. If the baby's vital signs worsen during the procedure, that is severe bradycardia or decreased oxygen saturation, it is usually preferable to stop, resume PPV with the mask, and then try again. Repeated attempts at intubation are not advised because you will increase the likelihood of soft tissue trauma and make subsequent airway management more difficult. If the initial attempts are unsuccessful, evaluate other options, including requesting assistance from another provider with the intubation expertise, or placing laryngeal mask or continuing face mask ventilation.
First, stabilize the baby's head with your right hand. Free flow oxygen should be delivered throughout the procedure. Holding the tube in your right hand, introduce it into the right side of the baby's mouth, with the curve of the tube lying in the horizontal plane. This will prevent the tube from blocking your view of the glottis. Keep the glottis in view, and when the vocal cords are apart, insert the tip of the endotracheal tube until the vocal cord guide is at the level of the cords. Stabilize the tube with one hand and remove the laryngoscope with the other. With the right hand held against the face, hold the tube firmly at the lips and/or use a finger to hold the tube against the baby's hard palate. Use your left hand to carefully remove the laryngoscope without displacing the tube.
What are the problems can occur while inserting the endotracheal tube? Laryngoscope not inserted for now. So you see the tongue surrounding the blade. So what is the corrective action is advance the blade further. And second one, laryngoscope inserted too far. You can see the walls of esophagus surrounding the blade. So the corrective action is withdraw the blade slowly until the epiglottis and glottis are seen. And the third one is laryngoscope inserted off to one side. You can see part of glottis off to one side of the blade. So you can do gently move the blade back to midline, then advance to retreat according to the landmark scene. how to do suctioning meconium via endotracheal tube. Connect the endotracheal tube to meconium aspirator and suction source. Occlude the suction port to apply suction. Gradually withdraw the endotracheal tube and repeat intubation and suction as necessary until newborn's heart rate indicates that positive pressure ventilation is needed. Suction for only 3 to 5 seconds as tube is withdrawn. If no meconium is recovered, proceed to resuscitation. If meconium is recovered, check heart rate. No significant bradycardia. Reintubate, suction again if needed. Significant bradycardia, then administer positive pressure ventilation.
Connect the endotracheal tube to a meconium aspirator, which has been connected to a suction source. Occlude the suction control port on the aspirator to apply suction to the endotracheal tube and continually withdraw the tube as you continue suctioning any meconium that may be in the trachea. Repeat intubation and suction as necessary until little or no additional meconium is recovered or until the baby's heart rate indicates that positive pressure ventilation is needed.
How to check whether the tube in endotracheal tube in position. The signs of correct tube positions are: the most important thing is improved vital signs, that is increase in heart rate, baby turns pink, and the activity, increased muscle tone. The presence of exhaled CO2 as determined by the CO2 detector. Both breath sounds over both lung fields, but decreased or absent over the stomach. No gastric distension with ventilation. So here, checking the breath sounds on both sides over axilla and the no sounds over the stomach shown in the second picture.
Colorimetric CO2 detectors change from purple to yellow in the presence of carbon dioxide. If the tube is in the trachea and there is adequate cardiac output, the color change should occur within 5 breaths.
What are the additional signs of correct tube displacement? There will be vapor in the tube during exhalation and the chest movement with each breath, giving back the positive pressure ventilation. And X-ray can be chest X-ray is the confirmation if the tube is remain in place past initial resuscitation. Direct visualization of tube passing between the vocal cord is the best way to confirm the position of the ET tube. So what are the ways we can find the tube is not likely in the trachea? The newborn remains cyanotic and bradycardia, and CO2 detector does not indicate the exhaled CO2. There is no breath sound over the lungs in the axillary area. Abdomen becomes distended. Air noises over the stomach. No mist in the endotracheal tube. The chest is not moving symmetrically with the positive pressure ventilation. These are the indications that tube is not in trachea. The radiological confirmation of trachea in the position. The first picture showing the trachea in the above carinal level, tube in the trachea. The second, it is two in the beyond the carina. So the ET tube is placed towards the right side of the main bronchus. This is the right position of the tube in the trachea. So above the carina, between the vocal cords, as shown in the picture. How deeply should the tube to be inserted within the trachea? The goal is to place the endotracheal tube, the tip in the middle portion of the trachea. This is generally requires inserting the tube so that the tip is only 1 to 2 centimeters below the vocal cords. It is important not to insert the tube too far so that the tip touches the carina or enter the main bronchus. Two methods may be used for estimating the insertion of depth. First method is NTL method. NTL method uses the calculation based on the distance from the baby's nasal septum to the ear tragus, as shown in the picture. The first picture is the nasal septum to the second picture is the tragus. The third picture showing the distance between the nasal septum to the tragus plus 1, that is NTL plus 1 centimeter. In this baby showing NTL is around 9 centimeter plus 1 is 10 centimeter. So we have to secure at 10 centimeter at the level of lip. How do you secure ET tube? After you have correctly positioned the tube, note the centimeter marking on the side of the tube adjacent to the baby's upper lip. Cut a piece of 3/4 or 1/2 inch tape so that it is long enough to extend from the one side of the baby's mouth across the upper lip and about 2 centimeters onto the opposite cheek. Split the tape along the half its length so that it appears like a pair of pants. Place the uncut section on the tape on the baby's cheek so that the beginning of the split is close to the corner of the baby's mouth. Place the upper leg of the tape over the baby's upper lip as shown in the second picture. Carefully wrap the lower leg around the tube as shown in the figure 3 and 4, but be sure that the desired centimeter marking remains next to the baby's upper lip. It easily to inadvertently push the tube in further and decide during the taping procedure. At the end, turn the tapes on itself to leave the small tap that you can hold, unwind the tape when you want to remove the tube. Listen with a stethoscope over the both sides of the chest to be sure the tube has not been displaced. If the tube will be left in the place beyond the initial resuscitation, take a chest x-ray for final placement of confirmation. During intubation, to limit the hypoxia, give pre-oxygenation with the positive pressure ventilation and deliver free flow oxygen during intubation and limit attempts to 20 to 30 seconds. Next, we move on to next alternative airway, that is laryngeal mask airway. Laryngeal mask airway is an airway device that can be used for positive pressure ventilation. Inflate the mask attached to an airway tube. The size 1 is the smallest size, 2 large for babies less than 1100 gram babies. This is the parts of laryngeal mask airway. The laryngeal mask airway having a 15 mm connector to connect with the positive pressure ventilation and the airway tube, and there is an inflatable cuff is there. So we have to inflate the cuff with air. When should the laryngeal mask should be considered? When we cannot ventilate and cannot intubate the baby, such a conditions, we can use laryngeal mask airway like craniofacial anomalies, cleft palate, small mandible or large tongue. What are the limitations of laryngeal mask airway? We cannot suction meconium through the laryngeal mask airway, and it is unknown if effective with chest compression or endotracheal emergency medications. May not be able to use high ventilation pressures because air leaking around the mask. It is too large for very low birth weight babies. How to insert a laryngeal mask airway? stand at the baby's hand and position the head in the sniffing position as you would for endotracheal intubation. Hold the laryngeal mask airway, and you may hold the laryngeal mask airway in your right or left hand, irrespective of your handedness. And gently insert the laryngeal mask after opening the baby's mouth. Press the leading tip of the mask against the baby's heart palate. While maintaining pressure against the palate, advance the device inwards with a circular motion. The mask will follow the contour of the mouth and palate. Advance until you feel the resistance. Inflate the cuff by injecting just enough air into the inflate port to achieve the seal. After inflating the cuff, remove the syringe. The maximum inflation for the mask demonstrated is 5 ml. Never inflate the mask with more than the manufacturer recommended volume of air. Attach positive pressure ventilation device and CO2 detector to airway tube and begin positive pressure ventilation. And press the piece of tape horizontally across the airway tube fixation tape, pressing downwards so that the tape adheres to the baby's cheeks, and gently presses the device inwards. So as shown in the pictures, hold the device as shown in the figure, gently open the baby's mouth and press leading tip of the mask against the baby's heart palate, and advance the device inwards until you feel the resistance. Inflate the cuff and fix the laryngeal mask airway and check the air entry on both sides, and connect positive pressure ventilation and CO2 detector and confirm the position. The LMA forming a seal over the glottis.
Place the baby's head in a sniffing position. Gently open the baby's mouth. Press the leading tip of the mask flat against the baby's hard palate with your index finger. Gently guide the device along the baby's hard palate toward the back of the throat, past the tongue into the hypopharynx until you feel resistance. Use your other hand to stabilize the LMA as you remove your finger. The tip should now reside in the esophagus. Use a syringe to instill 2 to 4 milliliters of air into the cuff. The LMA may move slightly outward when inflated. This is normal.
What problem should you consider if a baby's condition worsens after endotracheal intubation? Another than that is DOPE. What is DOPE? D stands for displaced endotracheal tube, O stands for obstructed endotracheal tube, P for pneumothorax, E for equipment failure. If a baby condition suddenly worsens after intubation, the endotracheal tube may have been inadvertently advanced too far into the airway or pulled back into the pharynx and outside the trachea. The tube may be obstructed by blood, meconium, or other thick secretion. The baby may have a developed tension pneumothorax that collapses the lung and prevents gas exchange. Finally, the device used to provide positive pressure ventilation may have become disconnected from the endotracheal tube or compressed a gas source, or it may have developed a leak. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. I am Dr. Mohammed Azif, Senior Consultant in the Department of Neonatology from Sri Ramachandra Medical College, Chennai. And our today's topic is, session's topic is how to give chest compressions. So the objective of this session is we should know what are the indications for chest compressions? What are the indications to start with chest compressions? And how are you going to perform a chest compressions? And it should be coordinated with chest compression with, I mean, a positive pressure ventilation. So how are you going to coordinate with chest compression and positive pressure ventilation? And when to stop chest compression? When to stop chest compression? These are the objectives of the session. So how it helps the chest compression? Chest compression, how it helps in resuscitation? It temporarily increases the circulation, increasing the cardiac output. Okay, it improves the coronary circulation first, thereby increasing the cardiac output, thereby increasing all the circulation, other circulations, vital organs circulations, brain, heart, and lungs, etc., etc. And it must be accompanied by a ventilation part. So ventilation always should be accompanied by, I mean, chest compression always should be accompanied by ventilation. And we can use 100% oxygen while the baby needs chest compressions. So we're now going to start the chest compression. So if the heart rate remains still less than 60 beats per minute, despite 30 seconds of effective positive pressure ventilation. So we have finished initial steps of resuscitation, baby not showing any improvement, and we have gone for a full cycle of bag and mask ventilation for 30 seconds, but still the heart rate is sitting at less than 60. At that point of time, we have to add on chest compressions with positive pressure ventilation. So how are you going to give it? You just compress the heart against the spine that means the heart is getting squeezed between spine and the sternum, and it increases the intrathoracic pressures so that the cardiac output as well as cardiac refilling will be there, and circulation, the cardiac output increases, so naturally the circulation to the vital organs including brain, liver, kidneys, everything is going to get improved. So that is the mechanism of giving a chest compression. So while going for chest compression, so automatically we need one more help also. We have to call that assigned person, assigned already for chest compressions. The ventilation part is taken care of by one person already. So we have to add on one more, we have to call upon one more person to continue chest compressions. Okay, and preferably, the baby is not already intubated, we can just go for intubation before going for a chest compressions. So coming to the chest compressions, one person will be doing the chest compressions, the other person will be continuing the ventilation part. We had two techniques are giving chest compressions, thumb technique and two finger technique. The latest recommended technique is only thumb technique, two finger technique is no more recommended. Thumb technique is the preferred one. It's less tiring and better control of compression depth. So that is the advantage. That's why we prefer to have thumb technique. So how are you going to locate the position of giving a chest compression? So locating is much more important. We cannot just simply do wherever you are. So run your fingers along the lower edge of the rib cage until you locate the xiphoid process. First, isolate the xiphoid process. Locate the xiphoid process. Just above the xiphoid process, in the middle of the sternum, you start giving. That is almost the lower third of the sternum you have to isolate and start giving the chest compressions. Place your thumbs or fingers on the sternum, in the lower third of the sternum, above the xiphoid process, and line connecting the nipples. You start doing it. Chest compression should be always coordinated with positive pressure ventilation. So how are you going to apply your fingers? The thumbs should be kept on the sternum, and fingers, all other four fingers will be just surrounding the, supporting the back of the baby. So I think you all can see the figure. So thumb should be kept on the lower third of the sternum, and fingers should be supporting the back of the baby, and baby should be kept preferably on a little bit harder surface. See, so this is the correct. Can you just see the correct method of giving pressure? Chest compressions. Apply pressure during compression from the sternum, releasing pressures to allow chest recoil and ventilation. Just apply pressures over the sternum and then take it out, release it out. But don't separate your fingers. Don't take your fingers out of the chest wall. You apply pressures, keep it in touch with the chest wall, but just relax the chest. Don't give pressures continuously. Just pressures to be applied, take it out, but don't take your fingers out of the chest wall. This is the thumb technique. Hope it is visible. So how are we going to give, the depth? How are we going to assess the depth? Preferably, the depth of sternum depression should be 1/3 of the anterior posterior diameter of the chest. So that much pressure we have to give. We cannot be so much rigorous and in giving it, as well as we cannot be so reluctant in giving pressures also. So at least 1/3 of the anterior posterior diameter of the chest should be reached while giving the compressions. Generally, the heart gets squeezed between the sternum and the spine. So the duration of the downstroke should be shorter than the duration of release. So downstroke should be a bit faster and rapid. Just take the hands, thumbs out. Just give some relaxation period for the heart to refill. So naturally, systolic period will be shorter than diastolic period. So make sure you are giving adequate pressure and not giving so much of pressures on the ribs, so that you can avoid some damage to the ribs and damage to the liver. So make sure we are not giving damaging any other internal organs. So be sure in giving adequate pressure to the sternum. So, and it should be coordinated. As I told you already, the chest compressions should be coordinated with the ventilation. So the person who is doing the ventilation part also should be coordinating with us. And how to coordinate? So one cycle of three compressions of the heart and one breath takes 2 seconds. Generally, we do like that in the same or systematic way. A cycle of 3 compressions and 1 breath takes 2 seconds. So over a period of 60 seconds, that is in 1 minute, we should have 90 compressions and 30 breaths. The breathing rate is 30 breaths per minute and the compression rate is 90 compressions per minute. Hope you all understand. So this equals 120 events per minute. So 30 plus 90. So total of 120 events per minute make a full cycle of chest compressions. So I'm repeating once again, total of 120 events, 90 chest compressions and 30 breaths per minute has to be delivered. And what is the rhythm? How are you going to maintain that coordination? It should be coordinated. I told you it should be coordinated. So how are you going to maintain the coordination? So the person who is giving chest compression should say 1 and 2 and 3 and breathe in. 1 and 2 and 3 and breathe in. 1 and 2 and 3 and breathe in. 1 compression and relaxation. 2 chest compression. 3 and relaxation. 3 chest compression. Same way. You all understand? So 1 should be compression. And is relaxation. 2 is compression. And is relaxation. 3 is compression of the chest. And is relaxation, followed by breathe. that person at that point, the person holding the bag should give breathe at that point of time. Okay, so 1 and 2 and 3 and breathe. 1 and 2 and 3 and breathe. And the same way it should continue without any interruption to almost for 30 seconds. Sorry, 60 seconds. Almost for 60 seconds it has to continue. So, okay. After 60 seconds, we gave chest compressions along with ventilation in a coordinated manner, and we're going to assess the heart rate now. After 60 seconds of coordinated CPR, we are going to assess the heart rate. Okay. So if the heart rate is more than 60, stop chest compressions. Okay. And continue positive pressure ventilation alone for another next 30 seconds. So if the heart rate is more than 60, stop chest compression and continue PPV for next 30 seconds. Clear? After 30 seconds of positive pressure ventilation, assess the heart rate. And then you can take a decision whether to continue that or we have to stop it. Clear? So if the heart rate remains still less than 60 after 1 minute of chest compressions coordinated with positive pressure ventilation, the heart rate remains still less than 60. So what are we going to do? You check the adequacy of ventilation. Are we really giving a proper ventilation and proper intubation? If already is not there, you can do it anyway. We have to check the adequacy of the ventilation. We have to check the efficiency of our chest compressions, as well as we have to prepare for umbilical venous catheters to continue for medications. So call that person, the allocated person, for preparing umbilical catheters to give epinephrine. Thank you all. Thank you so much.
Hi everyone. This is Dr. Prabha, senior resident in neonatology in Child Developmental Unit Hospital from Srihar. I'm dealing with the topic of medications under NRP program. So, starting with the learning objectives, when to give epinephrine during resuscitation, how to administer epinephrine, when to give volume expander, how to administer volume expander, how to insert an emergency umbilical venous catheter, or the objectives of today's session. So what is the indication for a medication in an NRP is, if despite adequate ventilation with 100% oxygen and chest compressions, heart rate remains less than 60, then we go ahead with medications. So the medication administration via the umbilical vein is the procedure described here, wherein we are placing a catheter in the umbilical vein, and it is a preferred route for IVISS, and it is like 3.5 French or 5 French or usually used in whole catheter in a sterile procedure. And the medication administration via the umbilical vein, insert the catheter 2 to 4 centimeter such that the tip is just below the skin level, and note the free flow of blood when aspirating. And then you have to insert with the less depth in case of preterm newborns. An insertion into the liver may cause damage to the liver. So take care and to avoid introducing air emboli into the umbilical vein during the procedure of introducing the umbilical vein. So the indications for epinephrine is as follows. So epinephrine is a cardiac stimulant drug, which is a potent alpha as well as beta adrenergic agent. Here it acts as an alpha adrenergic stimulant, wherein it is the heart rate remains below 60 beats per minute despite 30 seconds of assisted ventilation, followed by 30 seconds of coordinated compressions and ventilation. The total duration of 60 seconds in epinephrine is not indicated before adequate ventilation is established. Medication administration. Alternative routes are endotracheal tube and intraosseous insertions. Here the endotracheal tube is actually given even before the umbilical vein is inserted. When it has a time to insert the umbilical vein, we can give one dose of adrenaline into the endotracheal tube. The other route is intraosseous procedure, wherein the here they are not usually practiced in newborns, as they are not commonly used because of the small bones are fragile and the intraosseous space is also small in a premature infant. And so the alternative route for medication or volume expansion, if umbilical vein or other direct venous access is not readily accessible, then we can go ahead with the intraosseous line. The epinephrine administration recommended concentration is 1 in 10,000 and the recommended route is intravenously. Consider the endotracheal route while the intravenous access being obtained, and the recommended dose is 0.1 to 0.3 ml per kg of 1 in 10,000 solution. You consider 0.3 to 1 ml per kg if you are giving endotracheally, and the recommended preparation is 1 in 10,000 solution in 1 ml syringe or larger syringe if giving endotracheally, and the recommended rate of administration is rapidly, as quickly as possible. And the epinephrine, effects of epinephrine and repeated dosing or increases the strength. And the what does epinephrine do? It increases the strength and rate of cardiac contraction and increases the heart rate. It causes peripheral vasoconstriction. Repeat doses should be given via the umbilical vein, and repeat dose via the umbilical vein if the first dose is given via the endotracheal tube, as I have told you earlier. And when there is a poor response, like heart rate is still maintaining less than 60 and the epinephrine is not going to be effective, then you check the reach the effectiveness of ventilation, your chest compressions, your endotracheal intubation, and check the tube position whether it is placed properly, and then the oxygen is delivered equally. Epinephrine, how it is delivered, and consider the possibility of hypovolemia. So what are the indications for volume expansion? When the baby is not responding to the resuscitation and the baby appears to be in shock in the form of pale color, weak pulses, persistently low heart rate, and there is no improvement in cardiac status, circulatory picture, as well as despite among all these resuscitatory efforts, we have to think about volume expansion. And there may be history of condition associated with fetal blood loss, extensive vaginal bleeding, abruptio placenta, placenta previa, fetal trauma, twin to twin transmission, etc., any cord avulsion, all those things has to be questioned. And the recommended blood volume expansion is normal saline and acceptable, or alternatives are like Ringer lactitant or Rh negative blood when there is large blood loss of volume. Blood volume expansion dose and administration, recommended solution is normal saline, and the dose is 10 ml per kg with the recommended route of umbilical vein. Here it is prepared with the correct the volume drawn into the largest range, and recommended rate is given over a period of 5 to 10 minutes. The expected response, volume expanders, expected signs of volume expansion. The heart rate should be increasing, the pulses becoming stronger, paler is lessens, and the blood pressure increases. So follow up if hypovolemia persists, repeat the volume expanders at the dose of 10 ml per kg after the bolus of dose. So when the medication is still given and there is no improvement, and so recheck the effectiveness of your ventilation, chest compressions, endotracheal intubation, epinephrine delivery, and consider the possibility of hypovolemia. This is an algorithm. When you think the medication given had no improvement, then if the heart rate is still less than 60 or persistent cyanosis, or the baby is not able to ventilate with the heart rate absent, then consider airway malformations, lung problems such as like pneumothorax or diaphragmatic hernia, and even the congenital heart disease should be considered. So in these steps, consider discontinuing the resuscitation. This is umbilical vein catheter insertion picture, wherein the umbilical vein is shown as a big bore and the umbilical arteries are small, two arteries lying down, and this umbilical vein goes to the through the left hepatic vein into the inferior vena cava and then to the right atrium. So here as an NRP procedure, we need not go all the way to reach the IVC. We can just fix at the about 1 to 2 centimeter just below the umbilicus on the skin level as an emergency procedure, and then phazoni to the skin. This is the umbilical cord getting clamped, and then the cord is fastened at the base of the umbilicus, and the pursing structure is placed in the base of the umbilicus, and it is now under sterile precautions. The draping is done and the procedure is going to be followed. And this is the constricted umbilical arteries you can see in the picture, and above is the umbilical vein, yellow color arrow, where we are going to cannulate. And the first picture shows the umbilical venous catheter of 5 French size getting inserted into the umbilical vein. And the next, we are going to insert the umbilical vein after it getting inserted. We are pushing the saline and through a stop, three-way stopcock, the adrenaline can be pushed in, followed by rapid push of the normal saline. The first dose of epinephrine 0.1 to 0.3 ml per kg is then administered. So this is followed by the rapid flush of normal saline, and after it is placed in, a clear adhesive dressing is placed around the umbilicus, and the procedure is getting over. Thank you.